Hey gang, it's Ted Gravelin with today's TEDcast, and today I'm going to talk about something that I never talk about. I just rarely do, at least not in these little videos. Normally when I do these, I'm talking about something like an accounting problem or something with numbers or a sales problem or marketing or something like that. Today I'm going to talk about business coaching. And it's funny, I never talk about it because I'm a coach. You would think that I would talk about business coaching, but I just generally don't because obviously it's what I do now. And the quick 30-second version of how I got to be a coach, well, I was an owner first, okay? I started a business in 1988, ran it for a few years, had the normal struggles that people have, you know, being a technician, trying to run a business and not knowing what the hell I was doing. You know, didn't sell for the right prices, didn't understand how the business worked, thought I did. And then around 1993, ran into my first mentor coaching program. It was one of the first ones ever anywhere. Got into that group and went there. Kind of a funny story, back in those days, nobody had thought that the training materials should just get shipped to the participants at the end of the event. And I had to actually buy a suitcase from the hotel lobby. I bought a duffel bag. I actually still have it. Bought a duffel bag for, you know, 10 bucks or whatever, just to put all the extra books and stuff they gave us in, so I could have an extra checked bag to go home with, because it was like a lot of stuff, and no one had thought, how was that going to fit in everybody's suitcase? So went to that. I've taken every training out there. If someone's got a class, I probably took the damn thing. But got all the training materials from all the different places, found out what worked best, what worked easiest, what didn't work best, and what was like was a waste of time, and that kind of thing. So what I also figured out is that more was not better. Because you go to these, you know, training events, you go to a class, you go to a big convention or whatever, and you get all riled up for 4 or 5 days and it all sounds great. And then you come home and for the next 6 months, you don't really do anything with it. You just kind of sits on the corner in my office, and then I'm kind of doing business like we always did. That was really common until I learned, hey, every time you go to one of those things, pick out like the one thing you're going to do and come home and actually implement that thing. And that was, it took a couple years to figure out how to start doing stuff. So when I sold my business, I figured out that the things that we had done and the things that other folks had done that worked the best were the ones that we're going to talk about the most. But ultimately, we'll start with one question. Why do most company owners start their business? And no matter what answer we get, it always comes down to, if you think about it, it comes down to freedom. You want to have the freedom to do what you want to do and not have a boss telling you anything anymore. You know, like, hey, you know what? That guy's a jerk. My boss didn't treat me very well. Whatever reason, I can do it better than him. In my case, I thought I could do it cheaper than him, which was a mistake. So full disclosure, I didn't always do it right. You know, but in the end, it's I want to have the freedom. And after you start the business, you start to run it, pretty soon, really often, at least it happened for me and it happened for a lot of people I talk to that I know in this industry, the business starts running them instead of them running the business. It doesn't take very long before you're like, you know what happened to that freedom I was supposed to get, man? I haven't had a weekend off like in 4 weeks. I haven't had a weekend day off in, you know, a month or two, three. I haven't had a vacation in 2 years. My wife's getting a little upset, you know? Haven't seen my kids. I can't coach the soccer team or anything like that. I'm too busy. I've got no freedom. I don't have as much money as I thought I was going to have. I'm making a living, but it's okay. But I'm not doing as well as we thought. So what happened to that freedom idea? Well, it's pretty simple. What's happening is, in order to make it happen, one thing has to happen. So that's the why. Here's the what. What has to happen is you have to sell enough stuff to enough people at the right prices. Period. That's it. There's no other option. You have to sell enough stuff to enough people at the right prices. If you're not doing that, you are in trouble, okay? And we're going to break that down in a second, just go step by step here, and talk about how I do what I do and how other folks do what they do. Now, it doesn't mean anybody's program is, there's nothing wrong with them. Most of them have great information, and in some cases, too much information. Here's 10,000 pages of content you can look through. Here's 150 training videos. Here's another class you can take. Here's another class you can take. Here's marketing materials for every scenario you can come up with under the sun. And you're sort of like, oh my God, it's like drinking from a fire hose. Overwhelm. I don't know what to do with any of this stuff. And if you're lucky, you pick out a couple things and see if it works. What I did when I built my program is I built it specifically for contractors like $5 million and under. because it's most of the market anyway. And if you're above that, there's a different set of problems which are solvable, but we're going to talk about $5 million and under companies. There's like seven things I got on my board here that are the things that have to happen in order for a company to do well. Okay. You have to know your numbers. Bottom line, if you're a business owner, you are not allowed to say, well, my CPA does that. No, 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 no. You have to understand how all this crap works. You can't just put your head in the sand, and you can't trust when someone's saying, I'm making this margin and that markup and this net profit and that gross margin. No, you have to understand your numbers and you have to get that right. Most of the time when I'm working with a client, it takes about a week to get people down through their numbers. That's how we built the program, because we don't give you a bunch of stuff to do. I say, do one thing, do numbers, we'll be done with it, we'll move on to the next thing. Next thing is pricing. You got to have price books with some kind of published price book where you say something to show a customer, this is how much this darn thing costs, and this is how much we tell it to everybody. We're not taking advantage of you. There's the same number every single time. Like if I go into a restaurant and they hand me a menu, it's the same menu they give the other table. Okay, I'm not upset that the steak costs $56. I guess that's what it is for everybody. Okay, so you gotta have price books, and you gotta have it for service department, and you gotta have it for the replacement sales department. Okay, we're talking about residential companies here. You gotta have lead flow. Now, how you get there? Well, you use the service department training pricing as a tool so that you can get lead flow, because a certain number of your service calls will become replacement leads if you're using those tools correctly. Customers will naturally ask you, gee, how much is a new one? Good thing to when they ask you that, right? So lead flow. Sales process. You're going to have a sales process for your replacement sales. And of course, there are coaches out there who do sales training. That's all they do. They don't do the rest of it. They only do the sales training part. And they can make it really easy or they can make it really complicated. But ultimately, the idea here is to get enough people, sell enough, stuff to enough people, okay, at the right prices. That's the key. You're going to use your price books as a tool, one of the tools in your sales process, and the rest of the sales process should be a natural conversation. It shouldn't be forced. It shouldn't be hard to do. You shouldn't need to train on it for 3 weeks or 3 months to get good at it. It should be something that can happen pretty quickly, okay? So we spend like a week on this, a week on this, a week on this. Pretty soon you got about a month here and we're getting some real traction in this company. Happens real quick if you do this. Problem is if you start running off into a tangent where you're like, yeah, but I wanted to look at this other thing over here. Hey, should I do new construction? What about this project? Oh, what about if I go over here and do, you know what, time out. You don't have time to go running off and do 16 things at once. If you're trying to run a small company under $5 million, you don't have a division for new construction or anything like that stuff to really make any real money at it. And all it does is distract you from building your business. So you got to build these things. You got to do them in order. Okay. Then we get into agreements. Maintenance agreements, club memberships, you know, whatever you want to call it. There's got to have a way to build long-term longevity for your company with your customers, where your customers say, this is my guy, this is the company that I have, and you're going out there on a regular basis and you have some program for that. You have to have that, and it has to integrate in with the rest of your service department and your maintenance department and your sales department and that, so that everything is speaking in the same language and working from the same sheet of music. And, or, you know, think of it like pieces of a jigsaw puzzle. You know, if you take out the, you know, picture of whatever it is, you can't use a piece from one puzzle and pieces from another puzzle. They all have to be from the same puzzle or don't fit together, okay? So agreements are important. You gotta have a training program, and you gotta have that because in the end, no matter who you're gonna hire, you have to have a way to train them. Even if they have 10 years experience, they're not doing things your way until they've been trained. And frankly, in the way our environment is the last several years, it's really hard to find experienced guys. And if you're not finding experienced guys, you have to build them from the ground up. So you better have a good training program. And the more you grow, the more important that becomes, because, you know, when you're one or two trucks, you can probably get lucky and maybe find a guy who likes your personality and wants to work for you. But ultimately, if you want to build a dozen guys or have 10 trucks or 30 trucks, something like that, you're going to have that training program. And then marketing, as a business owner, you need to become a marketer. You need to understand how marketing works. Even if you're hiring marketing companies, and actually probably especially if you're hiring marketing companies, because before you spend a lot of money with them guys, it's a really good idea for you to know how it works so that you know that they're doing a good job or these guys are idiots. They don't know what they're doing, because heck, I do better than that. I'm not even spending any time on it, okay? So you need to understand how marketing works. By that, I mean, what's an offer look like? What's a headline look like? What does good ad copy look like? What are some of the rules and formulas for writing good ad copy, good formulas, good headlines, good offers, that kind of stuff? Because let's face it, a lot of offers out there are kind of, you know, really lame, where it's like, get my name out there. Here's my name. I hope you call me someday. It's not an offer. Okay. So that's how it normally works when I do it. How it works when most other companies do it, different ways. I don't think anybody really does what I do, where I just kind of roll them out one at a time. What they generally do is give you everything all at once and then kind of let you figure it out and then call when you need help. That's pretty typical. And if that works for you, great, but I don't like it that way. So I do it like this. Now, I'm going to do something different because I'm trying something new. Because one of the problems we run into is people get stuck, and they get stuck because of time, and they get stuck because they're not making any money. So it's time and money problem in that. So the first four things in here we do on purpose up front, because they're the things that make the biggest impact the fastest. And I figured out how to make it even faster. Okay. A lot of the coaching companies have hundreds and hundreds of clients. We're talking 400, 500, 600 clients. You know what I'm talking about if you've been to the big events and big conventions and stuff. Now, again, that's fun and it's really cool and all that stuff, and you get to meet some celebrity that they have as a speaker, and it's all cool and stuff like that, and nothing wrong with it. But sometimes you just need a little hand-holding to get through. And if they've got 500 clients, there's no way that they're holding your hand through a process to get stuff done really quickly. And notice I said get it done. Not just learn it, actually get it done so it's working in your business. What I'm going to do, take the first four things, instead of a week here, a week here, a week here, a week here, I'm going to walk through them one-on-one with people, and we'll do it in a week. In your business, done. New price books, know your numbers, lead flow, you understand how to use it, you understand how to do a sales process, you can sell stuff with your price books and do all that in a week, completely transform a business. Suddenly you have a boatload of money coming in with real profitability, with real numbers. And you get to spend that money then on other stuff later on, like training and, you know, recruiting people and marketing and stuff like that, growing your business. But the initial batch is to spend a week and bang it all out real quick. Now, in order to do that, it's going to have to be kind of one-on-one. I'm going to spend like every day on the phone, and not just call me when you need me. It's going to be, nope, we're getting up the next tomorrow morning and we're going to be on the phone and we're going to work through this. We're going to be on a Zoom call. We're going to work through this. You're going to be doing this pricing spreadsheet, and I'm going to be looking over your shoulder, or I'm going to be doing something and you're looking over my shoulder. This is how we're going to do it. Okay. It's a new thing I'm trying to do. If you want to do that program, I'm going to require a couple things. The first thing is I need to require somebody to be really coachable. It's not going to work very well if we have to go round in circles about whether it's going to work or not. Believe me, everything I tell you to do works. It's worked for everyone who's tried it, or I wouldn't be showing it to you, okay? Because believe me, like I said, I've tried everything. I've seen everything out there. That part works some of the time. Didn't work some of the time. But if it doesn't work some of the time, I ain't doing it. If it works every damn time, that's what I show you. So got to be coachable. Second thing is got to have commitment. Like, hey, I'm committed to this process. I'm not just trying it out to see how it goes. Nope, I'm all in. Let's go. Let's go, baby. That's it. And then the third thing is integrity, meaning I say I'm going to show up, I'm showing up, I'm going to do what I said I'm going to do. I expect other people should do that too. So, and I expect you should be running a company that has integrity for your customers and your employees. You're not trying to do anything underhanded to anybody. We all have to run from that, on that basis in the first place. Okay, so those are the three things I need. Now, what do we do next? If you want to talk about this, go to tedgraffam.com/booking. Book a time for a call. We'll talk about it. We'll see if it's a good fit. If it is, we'll enroll you in a program like that, and bang, 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 here we go. If it's not a good fit, that's cool. We can still be friends, okay? And so again, just go to tedgraflin.com/booking, click the link, pick a time on my calendar of the times available, and integrity, show up on the call at the time you said you're gonna. I'll give you a call, pick up your phone, actually answer it. It's kind of funny that way. And then we'll talk that conversation and we'll get this going. So that's the tip of the day and the TEDcast. I hope you liked it, and we'll talk soon.